The president issues an executive order as the vice president meets with a key Indiana legislator. This is the General Assembly prepares to enact new abortion laws along with inflation relief for Hoosiers. We'll hear from state lawmakers and discuss the economic impact with Senator Mike Braun and Congressman Andre Carson. It's all ahead right now on this week's edition of In Focus.
I want to talk about an executive order I'm signing to protect reproductive rights of women. In the aftermath of the Supreme Court's terrible, extreme, and I think so totally wrong-headed decision.
I think this is a prerogative of the states. I just think it's good that after 49 years, it's back to where it should have been in the first place.
I'm pleased that the president has finally acknowledge and address this issue publicly with an executive order.
Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm Dan Spieler. We're following new developments in the quickly changing battle over abortion in America. Friday, President Biden taking federal action, signing an executive order to try and preserve some abortion rights in the wake of the Supreme Court's landmark ruling overturning Roe v. Wade. Washington correspondent Raquel Martin has the latest.
The president himself acknowledges there is a little he can do to protect abortion rights in every state, but says today's executive order should help women and doctors now navigate a much different legal landscape.
What we're witnessing is a giant step backwards.
Friday, President Joe Biden signed an executive order designed to protect the now tens of millions of women living in states with new restrictive abortion laws. The order largely asks federal agencies to find ways to help women with travel, legal representation, access to contraceptives, and reproductive care.
The practice of medicine should not be frozen in the 19th century.
The announcement comes 2 weeks after the Supreme Court overturned Roe versus Wade and 2 months after that decision was leaked.
There are a lot of critics who believe the administration waited too long to respond to this. What is the administration's response?
Yeah, I mean, I sort of take issue with the premise of the question.
Friday, Jen Klein, the White House Gender Policy Council chair, insisted the administration was ready.
The day that the decision was released, the president spoke and very powerfully about actions that we were already going to take. The attorney general issued a very strong statement.
President Biden says the fastest way to restore women's reproductive care is by electing Democrats this November.
Vote, 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 vote.
And President Biden definitely hammered down on that last point. He says in order to pass a law guaranteeing abortion access in every state, there would need to be two more Democrats elected to the Senate, and they would need to maintain a majority in the House. For now in Washington, Raquel Martin, back to you.
Raquel, thanks. The president in his remarks Friday also referencing these reports from the Indy Star about a 10-year-old rape victim from Ohio who was forced due to a new Ohio law to travel here to Indiana instead.
This isn't some imagined horror. It's already happening. Just last week, it was reported that a 10-year-old girl was a rape victim in Ohio, 10 years old. And she was forced to have to travel out of the state to Indiana to seek to terminate the presidency. A 10-year-old girl should be forced to give birth to a rapist's child? I can tell you what I don't. I can't think of anything as much more extreme.
You saw the vice president there. House Minority Leader Phil Giaquinta of Fort Wayne was in Washington this week meeting with Vice President Harris and other elected officials from other states to discuss various ways to try and protect abortion rights moving forward.
I think the bottom line is, though, is that in the end, it probably comes up down to being a pretty big voting issue down in November. And I think that we as legislators or the president just have to remind folks what's online, what's at stake here in November, how important elections are.
Are you feeling a little hopeless in this moment when it comes to abortion? Because it seems like that's the sense in the party.
Well, no, I think that, again, constituents that I talked to, and this has really only been out there in the last 3 to 4 weeks. So the discussion was more about other issues that are going on. And I think a lot of people always thought that there was that backstop of the Supreme Court, that certainly they're not going to overturn Roe v. Wade. And certainly judging from what the nominees to the Supreme Court had said during their testimony, that it would be safe. And so now that it's happened, I think you're going to see really a lot of mobilization of voters, particularly women.
This is not an intellectual discussion and debate. This is real in the way that it is currently and will impact the women and the girls of America in a very direct way.
Now, the same day, Giaquinta met with the vice president, a major ruling here in Indiana impacting a proposal passed by lawmakers that had been held up in court, but not anymore. Our Steve Brown has the latest on the impact this could have on a particular second trimester procedure that lawmakers voted to restrict in most cases.
There is no medical evidence behind this type of a ban, and so there really is no reason that the Indiana legislature should be interfering in the ability of physicians to take care of their patients.
And Bernard won a court injunction. But that decision was based on prior Supreme Court cases of Roe and Casey. When the current high court overturned Roe and Casey, Indiana's Attorney General Todd Rokita asked a federal court judge to lift the injunction against the state law, and she did. Yesterday, Judge Sarah Evans Barker signed an order concluding, in light of the Supreme Court's recent decision, we hereby vacate the preliminary injunction entered in this case.
The immediate impact is that it's going to make it much harder for my patients, particularly those who, again, need procedures in the second trimester that are potentially in more difficult circumstances to access that care right away.
In a statement, Attorney General Rokita, a vocal anti-abortion advocate, said the court's ruling is an exciting battle victory in our war to defend the unborn and protect women. Indiana Right to Life also issued a statement, reading in part, "We have confidence in our elected leaders to further protect the unborn and to support and care for pregnant mothers in the upcoming special session." That special session begins later this month, although the Republican majority has not signaled what additional abortion restrictions it is considering.
Steve, thanks. Meantime, protesters gathered at the State House this past week in the wake of the Supreme Court's ruling on abortion. Indiana lawmakers technically now in a special session as of July 6th, but they won't actually meet until the 25th. The governor called the special session to provide inflation relief, but now the start of that session has been delayed as GOP lawmakers sort out various proposals to restrict abortion. Democratic lawmakers gathered inside the State House this past week to mark the unofficial start of the special session, criticizing the GOP for delaying inflation relief while they make plans to restrict abortion.
People need help now. It's so frustrating and tragic for us to watch this and to be sidelined for something like this that makes a difference in the lives of so many people. And the worst part is, this is absolutely senseless. We are technically in session now. The supermajority could pass this at any time, right now. Relief should not be held hostage to the supermajority's unpopular and disorganized policy debate. Our liberty and our livelihoods should not be subject to the whims of the supermajority.